Hello everyone, I am Nutan Khangar, working as Assistant Professor at Department of Statistics, KTHM College, Nashik. Welcome to the introductory course of C programming. The goal of this course is to learn how to code basic programs in the C programming language. In this lecture, I am going to discuss introductory part of C programming. Basically, the aim of this course is to teach you how to solve problems using a computer. So, this is our course structure. In this course, there are 5 units. In the first unit, we will discuss theoretical concept related to programming language, various operators, precedence of operators, and their expressions and also their evaluations. Control structures such as if-else, do-while, nested loops will be studied in second unit. In third unit, arrays will be introduced, whereas in fourth unit, functions will be discussed. We will study concept of pointers in fifth unit. And by the end of this course, I will hope that you can write medium-sized programs, maybe running to a couple of 100 lines of code comfortably in the C programming language. So there are 4 types of programming language. The first one is procedural language. It is a type of computer programming language that specifies a series of well-structured ways and procedure within its programming context to write a program. The next one is low level language. It is machine understandable language. Also, assembly is common in this language. It is internal machine code dependent. Low level language is run fast but slow to write and understand. C programming provides low level features that are generally provided by the lower level language. So we can say that C is very close to related to lower level language such as assembly language. The next one is middle level language. So C is a middle level language. Since C programming supports inline assembly in programming language, using inline assembly language feature in C, we can directly access system registers. So it is used to access memory directly using a pointer. C programming also supports high level language. Middle level language is more close to machine. It is far from the human. That is, human need to take more extra efforts for coding. We have to write more code to meet user requirement, and it is easy to create machine level code using C programming. The next one is high level language. It is human understandable language. It is internal machine independent language. Whereas we have seen that low level language is machine dependent language, but high level language is machine independent language. It is program oriented language. Also, it is developed for providing graphical user interface. Okay, so these are basically 4 types of programming language. Programming nowadays is considered a basic skill similar to mathematics that is needed across all disciplines like engineering, in the sciences, and nowadays even in the arts. So little bit of programming skill is an enhancement to any other skill set that you might already you have. This course we will start from the ground up. We do not assume any prior experience in programming, whether in C or any other language. So The focus will be to start from the basics and to use C as a medium of program. A couple of words about the process of programming. It involves two basic steps. One is to define the problem. Often you get real world problems which are not precise enough to write a program for. So the first step would be to define and model the problem. And this is a very important step in the large scale software development. However, we will not focus on this part as a part of this course. In this course, we will assume that the problem is well defined and already provided to you. So they will be precise and they will be fairly short and simple. So this is the first step of programming, which is definition of the problem, which you can assume will be given. Now comes the second step, which is to obtain logical solution to your problem. And what do we mean by a logical solution? A logical solution is a finite sequence of steps. Do this first, do this next. If a certain condition is true, do this. Otherwise, do something else. This is called an algorithm. So an algorithm is basically a finite step-by-step procedure to solve a problem. To implement algorithm, we use C programming. So we can define an algorithm is a procedure written in human language for solving a mathematical problem in a finite number of steps, or even you can say that it is a sequential solution of any problem. One way to visualize an algorithm is using a flowchart. If you are new to a programming, it is recommended that you draw flowcharts to define the solution to your problem. Experienced programmers very rarely draw flowcharts, but that is not a reason for beginning programmers to avoid flowcharts. Flowchart is a simple diagrammatic representation of an algorithm. It can be helpful for both writing programs and explaining the program to others. And on the ground of this definition of algorithm and flowchart, we can define programming is nothing but the sequence or set of instructions given to the computer in the systematic way and then produce some outputs. Another way you can be familiar with algorithms is when you have the or when you buy a make it yourself kit for a furniture or something like that, and you will be provided with a step-by-step instructions on how to assemble the kit. Often when you buy disassembled table or something like that, it will come with a sheet telling you how to start with the components and build a table. Those are also similar to an algorithm. So all this procedure to assemble a table from the disassembled table is nothing but an algorithm. So from that algorithm, you can get a sequential solution to assemble a table. It is written in your own language, that is, it is written in human language. That manual is provided to you. That is the first step towards your solution, and it is a procedure that describes the exact step to solve your problem. So defining a problem is there, then the process of coming up with an algorithm. This is a very important step in the programming process, and followed by this, there is a third step, which is to implement the algorithm in usual programming language. So is the concept of an algorithm is a new concept? No, I would claim that it is not new. An algorithm is a very familiar concept. The most important example that you can think of are cooking recipes. Now, cooking recipes are written in a way that they are almost algorithms. They are not quite precise enough for a computer, but they come quite close. Okay. Now, I will go for flowchart. Before that, I will discuss one example. Here, we have to write an algorithm to find sum of two integer numbers. So, the first step is start and the last one step is stop. Always keep in mind that you have to start and stop the process. Okay. So, the first step is start. Now, in the second step, you have to declare number 1, number 2 and sum. So, there are three variables. Since you have to add two integer variables, so two integer variables are nothing but number 1 and number 2, and you have to sum up that both integers which will stored in variable sum. Then the third step is read values for number 1 and number 2 and go to the next step. In that step, you have to add both number 1 and number 2 and assign the result to a variable sum. And the next step is print that sum and then stop. Okay. This is the algorithm. This is the simple algorithm to find sum of two integer numbers. Now, flowchart. We already have seen that it is a diagrammatic representation of an algorithm. It is very helpful in writing programs. Also, it is very easy to explain others. So let us look at a flowchart to depict a mathematical algorithm, and we will use this flowchart to explain certain conventions about how algorithms can be described. So every flowchart will have a start and end, and it will have a finite number of boxes. So this is the finite number of instructions that I was talking about. There are certain conventions in drawing flowcharts. The start and the end are often described in circles. There are ordinary boxes and then there are diamonds. So we will shortly describe what they mean. Okay. The first symbol is flow line. It is used to indicate the flow of logic by connecting symbols. That means if you have to go from step 1 to step 2, then the flow line will comes from step 1 and it will end at step 2. The second symbol is terminal. Terminal is used to represent start and stop of the program. The next symbol is parallelogram. You can call it as input or output. It is used to indicating the process of input and output. The next symbol is process. It gives instructions or internal operations inside the process or memory. For example, if you want to do some arithmetic operations, you can define in the process box. The next one is decision box, that is simple diamond. It indicates a question at which decision has to be made and answered in the format of true, false or yes, no. The next one is connector. It is used as a connector to show up a jump from one point in the process flow to another. And the last one is predefined process. It shows named process which is defined elsewhere. So suppose you want to write an algorithm for finding sum of two integers, and all of you know how to do it. The point is how to describe this step by step to somebody who does not know it already. So here I have drawn flowchart. The first symbol is terminal, that is used for start, and the last one symbol is also terminal where your program will end. The next one is a parallelogram in which you have defined number 1 and number 2. In the next rectangle box, that is process box, in which we can add up two numbers or we can do arithmetic operations there. And then again in parallelogram, we have to print sum and then we have to stop. So this is the simple flowchart to find sum of two integer numbers. Now we are going for the general structure of programming. So we will start program with comment box. Comment is a programmer readable explanation, or in a simple language, comment tell us for what the programming is to be done. You can put comments in middle of the program also, by which we can have understanding in which way we are dealing with the algorithm. Now the next step is input header files. There are many header files. Mainly in this course we will use three header files: stadio.h, cuneo.h and math.h. So stadio.h is a header file which is standard input output file, where cuneo.h is a console input output file. If you would like to use some mathematical functions like trigonometric functions or logarithmic functions or exponential functions or square root, you have to use the another header file, that is math.h. Okay, then next one is prototype of user defined function. Okay, which prototype you have to use? For example, if you are using some keyword and it should be either in three of the header file. The next one is library function, which is already defined by the system. The next one is user defined function. We have to define our own function. Then the next step is variable declaration, and then the main body of the program will come. Here I have taken a simple example. We will go with the last example as, that is to find the sum of two integer numbers. So here we are finding the addition of two numbers. So here our comment is, so I have start the comment with slash star, and our comment will end with star slash, and the comment is to find sum of two integer numbers. Even you can start comment with double slash also. So our comment is here to find sum of two integer numbers. Now the next steps come, that you have to input header files. Here I have used two header files. One is stadio.h and another is cuneo.h. Here the printf should have prototype function, and which is in stadio.h, and getch also have prototype function which includes in cuneo.h. The next one is void main. This function takes arguments and returns some value. One point we have to keep in mind, that the program start executing from this main function. Void main indicates that the main function will not return any value. Instead of void main, one can use integer main. Integer main indicates the main can return integer type data. When our program is simple and it is not going to terminate before reaching the last line of the code, or the code is error free, then we can use void main. But if we want to terminate the program using exit method, then we have to return some integer values, zero or non-zero. In that situation, the void main will not work. So it is good practice to use integer main over the void main. Then after that, we have to start program with curly bracket, and also we will end with program curly bracket. So here I have opened curly bracket. Then the variable declaration comes. Here we have defined three variables, which is integer variables. Since we know that the sum of two integer numbers is also integer, that's why the variable sum is also defined as an integer variable. So the A is first number, B is second number, and the sum is the third number in which we have to store the sum of two integer numbers. So here I have assigned the value of 5 to A, and the value of B is 3, and the next step is do the arithmetic operation. So here we have to do sum is equal to a plus b, and then we are printing that sum. So we have used to print that sum, that is printf. So printf, what we have done, sum is equal to percent d. Percent d, d stands for, since our sum variable is integer variable, that's why we have written there d. And the last one is, we have to, before closing the curly bracket, we have written getch. Getch, it is non-standard function, and it present in conio.h header file. It blocks the screen until you press any key. So here our program will complete. Before running the program, you have to compile the program first, and after that you can run the program. So here we will stop. Now thank you for your cooperation. We will see in the next lecture data types and different tokens in C. Okay, so here we will stop. Thank you.